Hello, everyone. As we're giving folks a few more seconds to trickle on in, I want to welcome you as the ethereal voice on the internet to our Change and Challenges in Advancing Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion in STEM. My name is Annabelle. I go by she, her, hers. I am the current committee chair for the National Science Policy Network's Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Committee, and I'm so glad to see you all here today. As one of our members here, Tristan, is sharing to everyone, if you need access to some captioning, we have that available through AADR AI, and that's through our live stream that you can get. Usually it is on the left-hand side that you can click on and get access to the transcription notes. Alrighty. And we're going to kick off the event today with just a quick overview of the two hosting organizations. I mentioned before, I'm a part of the National Science Policy Network, and it is a growing organization focused and built by early career STEM professionals in training and engaging our peers in science advocacy, policy, and diplomacy. As you can see here, this is just a snapshot of where we're at currently and how we're just trying to grow across the US. And of course, with our diplomacy arm, we have had folks internationally interact with us within the network. And so stay tuned towards the end of the webinar and we'll try to wrap up and share some links on ways you can get plugged in and involved within NSPN. And then I'll hand it off to my co-conspirator, Melissa Varga.
Thanks, Annabelle. Yeah, hey everyone, I'm Melissa Varga. I'm the Science Network Community and Partnerships Manager at the Union of Concerned Scientists. If you have managed to log in with my name, please feel free to change it back. Sorry about that little tech issue, but thanks all for joining. And I wanted to start by acknowledging that systemic racism has fundamentally shaped our institutions, including science organizations, to consciously and unconsciously uphold white supremacy. And for most of our 50-year history, the Union of Concerned Scientists inhabited this space without much thought, honestly. And it was only after a public letter from a former staffer in June of 2020 that we truly began to grapple with the deeper structural racism that has existed across our organization and the harm that we caused. I believe that we have begun to take meaningful steps to be towards becoming an anti-racist organization. You can check out our one-year update on our website detailing the changes that we've already made. But I know that we will continue to make mistakes, and we are committed to continuing these efforts in the long term, just recognizing that it is a journey and an evolution for us as an organization. And I share this with you because I think it's important to be upfront and honest about where we're coming from, and we need partners and supporters to hold us accountable and to join us on this journey. And I think today's discussion is an important step towards continued learning, transparency, and humility that we desperately need within the scientific community. So I'm really looking forward to this conversation, and I'm grateful to NSPN for co-leading this effort with UCS.
I will go ahead and stop sharing here, and I will let our moderator, EM Gayek, take it away.
Hello and welcome to everyone. As Annabelle said, my name is William Gayek, but I go by EM. Thank you for joining us today. Today, we have the pleasure of having four distinguished panelists with us today from four separate societies. We have Dr. Makyba Charles-Ayinde, who is the Director of Science Policy at the American Association for Dental, Oral, and Craniofacial Research. We have Michael H. Maloney, the CEO, the Chief Executive Officer of the American Institute of Physics. We have Billy Williams, the Senior Vice President for Ethics, Diversity, and Inclusion at the American Geophysical Union. And we have Dr. Crispin Taylor, the Chief Executive Officer of the American Society of Plant Biologists. Today, we'll start off with Dr. Makyba Charles-Ayinde and with her introduction to DEI at her society.
Thank you, William. So good afternoon, everyone. My name is Makyba Charles-Ayinde, and I am the Director of Science Policy with the American Association for, for Dental, Oral, and Craniofacial Research, which I am going to shorten to AADOCR because it's quite a mouthful. Next slide, please. So I wanted to give a brief introduction to our association and some of the core pillars and our values that we believe in as it relates to DEI. So our mission statement is to drive dental, oral, and craniofacial research to advance health and well-being. And I will take it a step further by saying that our vision statement is oral health for the world, right, through discovery and dissemination. And this for the world is not a blanket statement at all. We believe that oral health is important to all, irregardless of race, ethnicity, sexual orientation, religion, no boundaries, no barriers. And we implement that throughout a lot of the programs that we have in our organization. Next slide, please. So we are built on three core values: scientific excellence, social responsibility, and scientific community. But I do want to highlight just one of these pillars of our value statement, which is social responsibility. Next slide. So IADR values the pursuit of scientific excellence, and we really do believe in addressing inequalities and inequities that may exist throughout dental health through the research that we do. And the one of the crux of that is the fact that we have a really robust community of scientists, and we provide a platform for these scientists to weigh in, to network with all their different perspectives and share the types of research that they are doing in areas that may be important to them. Next slide. We have 32 scientific research groups and networks, and they really span the breadth of oral health. But in particular, I do want to identify several of them. One is our Global Oral Health Inequalities Research Network. So bringing together researchers who are working on oral health inequalities globally. We also have, and since this is a student focused group and early career focused group, we do have a student training and research network. And through that, we basically provide a grant through which someone at the PhD level can travel to another researcher in another institution and learn about some of the things that they are doing there. So that basically allows students who may be at not so much of a research intensive institution to be able to be like an exchange student and travel over to one that is really strong in research and with a lot of NIH grants, and to learn some of the techniques and some of the research that they are doing there. I also want to highlight our Women in Science Network, very, very close to my heart. We're basically bringing together female leaders in dental, oral, and craniofacial research to identify some of the problems that may be impacting that subpopulation of our citizens, and addressing that through different collaborations that they may come up with. So here we have a powerful group of women moving forward to change the narrative around research and leaders in research. And then we also have our National Student Research Group. This group is extremely active in bringing together students from across the US, in fact, internationally, who have an interest in oral health research. And what is important through their activities is emphasizing the need for different perspectives throughout this research area. Next slide, please. So a little bit more about our student research group, tons of activities that they do throughout the year, culminating in our annual meeting that we have each spring, barring COVID events, of course. We did have to switch to a hybrid mode for 2022. Next slide. So a lot of awards and fellowships to support students who may be coming from those underrepresented or underserved groups and are interested in doing research. We have more than 40 of them. Some are specific to those underrepresented populations, and others encourage applications from those groups. We have grants that will help a student, an early researcher, to establish their lab at a new institution. So that's our Procter & Gamble Underrepresented Faculty Research Fellowship. We have grants for students to attend our annual meetings so that they can network with researchers, perhaps secure a research opportunity with a mentor. And that's some of our block travel grants. And we have tons of competitions where we encourage students to put forth their out-of-the-box ideas to be able to have an opportunity to get a grant or to win some funding to support that research. Next slide. So I would be remiss if I don't ask you guys to follow us on Twitter and all the different platforms that we have to learn more about when these fellowship and grant opportunities are active, when are the windows for you to apply, if you are interested in oral, dental, or craniofacial research. And I think I have one more slide. Oh, that's it. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Makyba. Next up, we have Michael Maloney.
Thanks, Ian. And I don't have any slides to share with everybody, but it's so great to see close to 100 colleagues join this webinar today from all across the STEM with two M's community and to discuss this really important topic. So I was going to start by just giving some background to AIP and then also our work. So we're a little bit different than the other organizations represented here on this panel today, in that we are a federation of professional societies in the physical sciences. And so we are an organization which has 10 member societies and 27 affiliated societies that work to advance, promote, and serve the physical sciences. So we don't have individual members, but our member societies do. But currently we're engaged in a major strategic transformation at AIP. And that transformation is being driven by what we call AIP's strategic framework that was adopted by the Institute's board of directors back in September 2019. The overarching strategy in that framework is to advance the physical sciences with a unifying voice of strength from diversity. And within the framework, it calls for AIP to lead the physical sciences community toward an impactful understanding of how to be more welcoming to and supportive of the full diversity of physical scientists throughout their education and careers. These are other references to what we at AIP call diversity, equity, inclusion, belonging, and accessibility, DEIBA for short, are really integrated deeply in both the vision for AIP provided by the framework, but also our implementation efforts to realize that vision. As an organization, we recognize AIP's own role as part of a larger societal construct that perpetuates racism, exclusion, discrimination, and inequity. We are committed at AIP to addressing that by building DEI into every level of our strategy, not as a standalone item, but to integrate it into all aspects of our strategy at every level in our organization. We've also adopted a diversity statement and we live by it. And we aim to be vocal beyond our inner core community to the broader community in fora such as today. And we strive to really lead by modeling and shifting to an equity mindset as we seek to partner with other organizations for greater impact. One approach to our being very intentional and transparent at AIP about the way we pursue DEIBA was the adoption in November 2019 of a resolution which was inspired by our commitment to diversity in our framework. In it, our board of directors lays out what diversity means for AIP and what our commitment entails. And so rather than talk about some of the program elements that we have in play currently, and I'd be happy to touch on those during the course of our discussion, I thought outlining what's in that diversity statement and resolution by our board would be a good place to position AIP's perspective, at least for this discussion. AIP believes at our core that inclusion of diverse individuals within the physical sciences community is vitally important to the health and well-being of the scientific enterprise. We know from empirical evidence that diverse perspectives lead to better solutions to problems, better solutions to problems, better decision-making, and better outcomes. We understand that discrimination, exclusion, and inequity are ethically wrong and damaging, both to those affected and to the scientific community, thereby squandering precious talent. Further, we believe that being ever mindful of diversity enhances AIP's understanding and responsiveness to the experience and needs of our communities, thereby improving our ability as an organization to respond to the ever-changing environment of those whom we serve. We recognize that all individuals or institutions are not afforded equal access to resources, support, or opportunities. We believe that attention and commitment to equity within the scientific enterprise are absolutely necessary to enable the success of the individuals and institutions within our community. Fostering equity and a sense of belonging for all who are part of the AIP community requires coordinated action and change across a broad range of institutions. As a federation of physical science professional societies, AIP embraces our unique opportunity and responsibility for advancing equity in our community. In that regard, we continue to learn from, support, and collaborate with our member and affiliated societies to promote greater diversity, equity, inclusion, and belonging across the physical sciences. More specifically, we seek to exemplify an institution committed to the principles of equity mindfulness, consciously focusing on equitable outcomes for our colleagues and the communities we serve through all of our institute's policies, programs, and actions. We are committed at AIP to establishing a workplace at AIP that serves as a model for collaboration, respect, diversity, equity, inclusion, belonging, by ensuring that these values are embodied in our practices for convening, for volunteer recruitment and service, for hiring, for our management policies, and for our retention activities. As part of our commitment to integrity, accountability, transparency, and openness, we at AIP work to establish comprehensive policies and goals with respect to these issues and make them broadly known and accessible. We actively and regularly evaluate our progress and solicit feedback from our staff, from our member societies, and other stakeholders in this regard. So in closing, I'm really grateful to the organizers and sponsors of today's event to discuss these critically important matters. These kinds of dialogues, and indeed, more importantly, the actions we take as professional societies, associations, and in our case, a federation in STEMM, allow us to step forward as a welcoming community, a community where everyone can bring their authentic self to our national and global STEMM endeavors, and where we can pursue together our broader and shared vision of tackling the deepest issues of racial and social justice in STEMM. So I'm really looking forward to engaging in the conversation with all the participants today and with my colleagues on the panel. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Mr. Maloney. Next up, we have Mr. Williams from the American Geophysical Union.
Thank you, William. Can you see my slides okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Well, they're advancing without me trying. So first of all, thank you for being here, and thank you for hosting this session. Again, my name is Billy Williams. I serve as Executive Vice President at AGU for Ethics, Diversity, and Inclusion. And I'm going to spend a few minutes talking to you about the things we're doing at AGU, but to put this first in the context for you, because I'm sure not all of you are familiar with AGU. So a little bit about who I am and who is AGU. So AGU is about 60,000 members, Earth and Space scientists across 145 countries. 41% of our members are from outside the United States. And I point that out because that influences how we define diversity, equity, and inclusion, and things we try to address as we go forward. We are organized by disciplinary sections such as seismology, hydrology, atmospheric sciences, geohealth, global environmental change. So there are about 25 sections within our organization. We sponsor scientific publications. We have about 25 peer-reviewed publications, international meetings. Our largest meeting is our annual fall meeting, which will typically have anywhere between 22 and 26,000 participants. A full range of honors and awards, career services, public affairs. We're pushing now into what we're calling community science advocacy, so dealing with issues around environmental justice. And we have some expertise that we are offering into that space. Our organization is headquartered in Washington, D.C. Approximately 130 staff members. Our CEO is Randy Feiser. And again, I serve as the Vice President for Ethics, Diversity, and Inclusion. My office has four staff members working full-time in this space. And I put here, I'm not an HR person. I'm saying that just to let you know that my office does not deal with compliance related issues at all. We deal primarily with trying to educate and advance DEI across our membership. We do get called in to help educate staff members on occasion, but my focus is not in our AGU staff at headquarters, it's more across our membership. A little more context around our demographics. AGU is about 32% women scientists. Has grown rapidly since the year 2000, when we were only 17%. So that helps give a context for who we are. We're also about 30% of our membership are what we call student members. And students for us are either graduate students, or in some cases they are postdocs. So when we have our large annual meetings, about 30 to 33% of our participants are from the student population, very few of those being undergraduates, but mainly grads and postdocs. I know postdocs don't consider students anymore. Here's a profile of the various countries we operate in. We have a lot of work to do in terms of representation and services in the Southern Hemispheres, Africa specifically. You can see we only have 226 members out of the continent of Africa. So we have to do better there. Also in the South Americas, only 3,000 out of 60,000. So there's a lot of work that we are doing in our introspection of who we are and where we serve and who we serve. So our growth in this area, our leaning into diversity, equity, and inclusion started with, and I would say in earnest, we've always had a DEI diversity inclusion strategy or a plan. But in 2017, we adopted a new ethics policy. And in that policy, we define discrimination and harassment and bullying as scientific misconduct. So we were one of the first societies to do that. And in naming it as scientific misconduct, we also follow up on issues associated with harassment. And I say this because this is where we spent a lot of time in between 2017 and 2019 focusing on issues of harassment in science. And that was necessary because in our space, in the earth and space sciences, a lot of our membership gained their credentials by doing field work. And what we learned was a lot of harassment and other unprofessional behavior has historically taken place in field camp experiences. And our membership, our female membership, especially women scientists, were fed up with it. Our early career scientists were very vocal about this. And so we leaned very heavily into addressing those issues. In 2018, our diversity committee stood up a put forward for the board and council to consider an AGU diversity and inclusion strategic plan, which set us up as our vision for AGU to be a model organization in this area. And then in 2020, so just last year, AGU updated its strategic plan. So overall strategic plan now has modeling and promoting inclusive scientific culture as one of the three primary strategic goals for AGU. And what this means is that everything you see in AGU on all of our programs and efforts, you will see DEI incorporated through it throughout. And last year, and as a result of the George Floyd killing, AGU adopted or went very public with a lot of actions that we are undertaking to address systemic racism. I won't go through all these. You can see those in your handouts. But we are tracking all of these items, including how much our attention to this area for funding, for mentorship, diverse meetings, diversity in publications, in how we advocate for policies that eliminate racial injustice. One of the other initiatives I'll talk about is we have established a dashboard that is very public, but it's presented for board and council on an annual basis, where we track our progress across all of our programs, including qualitative measures. So not just quantitative, what are the numbers, but how are people experiencing AGU? And so we have a baseline in place now that we will use as we go forward. Also, we also are very public with our demographics of our staff, the 130 staff members. We look not only at gender ratios, but race and ethnicity, but also we look at it by job level. So some organizations will say they're diverse, but if you look at the stratification within job level, you see that diversity is probably down at the bottom levels, but not at the higher levels. So we are transparent with these numbers. So we publish these to the public. And then recently, two other initiatives I would mention here. One is co-founded the Society's Consortium to Address Harassment in STEM. This organization now has 130 members and is looking more broadly, not just at gender harassment, but also looking at a lot of intersectional issues as well. And finally, I'll mention to you a very recent initiative of ours that you might be interested in. It's called AGU Landing, where we have a community of practice with a host of resources that are available across STEM with two M's, and also an academy where we select cohorts of individuals who receive intense professional development to equip them to be DEI change leaders. And within the community of practice, there's a spot for anyone. You can find your community. We have community managers to help advance the learning in these areas. So the community of practice is just now launching. We'll launch it in December at our annual meeting. And if any of you are interested, please contact me. We're happy to have you or your organizations join us in this effort. So again, I see our charge and responsibility as professional societies is this, that we are in a very unique position to lead and promote positive DEI change. And I say this because my firm belief is that we can do this more effectively, more swiftly than probably any other institution, faster than the government, faster than your academic institution. So we take this role very, very seriously. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Williams. Next up, we have Dr. Crispin Taylor from ASPB.
Great. Thank you very much. Like Michael, I also don't have slides. I want to thank the organizers for affording the opportunity to AHPB to present and discuss with you all this afternoon around the DEI issue and society's role in affecting change. And thank you all for participating and taking the time to be part of this conversation. Looking towards getting that discussion started, I'll try and keep it quick here. Unlike the other three organizations that you've heard from, AHPB is relatively small. We're about a $7 million annual budget, 3,000 members globally, around 20 staff. We emphasize journals, conferences, and supporting and nurturing our communities. It's a strongly academic organization in its focus and governance, and most of the current leadership are faculty at R1 universities in the United States. Our small size and the general fragmentation of professional organizations in biology often means that to have any real impact, we have to collaborate and take on collective action with sibling organizations. And I'll unpack that for you in just a minute. The society itself is approaching its centennial, and we aim to change rapidly over the next few years to become a very different and very much more welcoming organization by the time the centennial arrives in 2024. What we have done to date, for the most part in DEI space, I think could be classified as fairly conventional. And if I'm honest with you all, I think we're a number of years behind the AGU and the AIP in terms of systemic change. But we have a profound opportunity to start making those changes very soon in collaboration with a number of other organizations in our sub-discipline. We have position statements, we have dedicated travel awards, we have codes of conduct and accessibility accommodations at conferences online and in person. And we're a founding member of the Society's Consortium on Sexual Harassment and STEMM that Billy just mentioned. Nevertheless, unlike AGU and AIP and Michaela's organization, we don't have DEI baked into structurally and in or into strategic plans. We're about to begin a strategic planning process that, like the ones you've already heard about, will not have DEI as sort of a side thought, but as a main theme that permeates everything that we do as an organization for the reasons that you've already heard articulated. We're also beginning to expand the ways we think about diversity, equity, and inclusion to include social justice and factoring in social justice considerations around locations for conferences, and also using our conference, physical conference footprints, whenever we're able to do that again, to extend what we're doing as a community into the local communities in which we are physically located for conferences. More recently, in partnership with an organization called the North American Rhabdopsis Steering Committee, we have begun to develop a website, a resource that's aimed at informing our memberships about diversity and inclusion and sharing some of the research that and other discoveries that Michael mentioned that provide the sound evidence basis for the importance of DEI. In addition to the human and social manifestations of that importance. One particular plank in that exercise is it does two things. We call it front and center, and I'll put this link in the chat as well. It is about raising the visibility of diverse folk in our communities to our community at large, simply by sharing information about who they are and what they're interested in. And what their identities are. The second part of this, though, is a private Discord server for individuals who identify as minoritized to find safe spaces to communicate one among another and avoid the structural biases and impediments to progress and participation and belonging that we've heard about and undoubtedly we'll hear more about as the afternoon unfolds. ASPB has also been part of broader visioning exercises, and I was intrigued to hear from Ian about his interest in professional development more broadly. ASPB was part of an RCN, now expired, a research coordination network funded by the National Science Foundation that included several organizations in plant science. And among the things that group did was to publish some recommendations around training that were aimed in large part at dealing with some of the structural biases and structural impediments that, that make it harder for some people to participate in our research and in professional development and career progression in STEM. And some of these I'm pleased to see are beginning to be manifest in some of the programs that are coming out of the NSF, for example. Speaking of the NSF, the big news for ASPD and the plant science community more generally is that we've recently been awarded a $2 million grant over 5 years from the NSF. The we in this case is ASPD, half a dozen other plant science organizations, three organizations serving minoritized communities, a couple of companies, and some in-kind support from the Howard Hughes Medical Institute, which also has a profound interest in changing the landscape for diversity and inclusion in STEM. The award was made through a request for proposals, a dear colleague letter, the link to which I posted in the chat, called LEAPS. It recognizes what Billy just said at the end of his talk, which is that as professional societies, we can and should and must be engines for change in this space. And leading change in communities is intended to propagate that change from beyond the professional societies that are involved and are the engines of change into the broader communities that we serve and support and nurture. And I believe that the NSF, the biology directorate that created this program, has that recognition behind the objective to fund the plant sciences, in our case, also cell biology and ecology as well, received awards. And it's American Institute of Biological Sciences under the first set of program announcements. So our project is called Root and Shoot, which stands for rooting out oppression together and sharing our outcomes transparently. I'll put a blog post so you can read more about that in the chat. But basically it's a three phase effort. Phase one is about identifying and dealing with the sort of, call them low hanging fruit isn't the right phrase, but the most obvious impediments to diversity and inclusion and addressing them systemically across our organizations. Things like conference codes of conduct and the capacity to report and respond to allegations of harassment, bullying, and inappropriate behavior in this space, not just around conferences. The second phase is to take a deep dive into the leadership structures of our organizations and to identify where we must improve those structures to increase diversity, inclusion, belonging. Some of this work has already started on an ad hoc basis at ASPD, specifically as we welcome a new editor-in-chief for one of our two self-published journals. That individual has made it very clear that diversifying the editorial board is a priority for them and has reached out to the diversity committees at ASPD and the publications committee to start making that happen in a partnership, partnered manner. So I'm excited about that. In terms of how our professional societies DEI initiatives have evolved, where I have been able to directly affect change, I have. Billy also mentioned staffing, and ASPD staff is at all levels is much more diverse than it was ever has been before. As an organization, I think the leadership energy behind DEI initiatives until the Root and Shoot Award arrived has waxed and waned with the enthusiasm brought by specific leaders. But overall, our DEI initiatives are becoming more ingrained. And as I said, we have a strategic planning process about to unfold in the first quarter of next year, where I anticipate this is going to be much more thoroughly ingrained in what we do. And as I said, the Root and Shoot grant will allow us to unpack current leadership structures in all of the participating organizations across plant biology, and as necessary, reassemble them in ways that are more inclusive, welcoming, and most important of all, provide lasting impact and embedded change. So that, as I stated at the beginning, we are a fundamentally different organization at the end of these 4 or 5 years than we are now. And I'll stop there and thank you for your time and attention.
Thank you so much, Dr. Taylor. And thank you again to our four panelists. At this time, we're going to move into our moderated question and answers for about 15 minutes. And then afterwards, we'll be taking audience questions directly to ask the panelists, including some questions that have already been submitted via the registration links that everyone registered on. So the first question to the panelists, what should professional societies do or provide for marginalized communities and individuals?
I guess maybe I'll volunteer to start by just sort of repeating a little bit what I said in my opening remarks and giving a couple of examples. And I already talked about, and I think others have mentioned, about really building DEI into the very core of the organization. And so it's not just a singular goal. It's not just a program or an office, but it is, to riff off Crispin a little bit, it is a root and branch. It's part of every bit of the organization in thinking and in every program area. The other is to really to adopt a diversity statement that's clear and one that we as organizations live by and refer to. And that was one of the reasons why I started off today by just refocusing again on that statement back from 2019 as being a really pivotal moment in the organization for recognizing our responsibility. And so returning to those statements and those core principles is really important to really build a sense of community and to be a voice not only within your community, but to reach out. And we've done that through a number of program areas as well as through engagements like this and work as Crispin and others will know that I've been engaged in really trying to build a community in the whole STEMM community for diversity as well. And really as we also mentioned too, about modeling the behavior that we are trying to promote in the broader community. So again, I think those were worth repeating as being some of the core strategies and tactics, if you will, that as professional societies, and in our case, a federation, we aim to really build into all that we do.
I'd just like to add really quickly to everything that Michael said. We definitely try to incorporate at AADOCR, but what we actively work on is the imposter syndrome and that entire mentality that persons from underrepresented populations tend to struggle with. The science has shown it, the data is there. So a lot of our programs focus on showing these communities leaders who look like them, who come from their circle, their communities, that are moving the needle in the research that they are interested in doing. So we have a lot of programs that focus around just showing that. So one is Faces of Dental Research, where we show, you know, researchers who are really making an impact in dental, oral, and craniofacial research. And we tend to make sure that we have diverse perspectives at the table every opportunity that we can. So, you know, manuals are a thing of the past. We want to make sure that we have females well represented to bring a voice to that subgroup of persons. Because, you know, in our office, yes, we're diverse. As researchers, yes, we're diverse, but we also serve a community with the types of research that we do. So we want to make sure that all those voices are present each and every time we have some sort of program, some sort of initiative. And I'll just round up by saying we tend to invest in the next generation of leaders. We have programs that serve the undergraduate population, PhD level population, and early career researchers, you know, bringing a lot more of people of color to those opportunities.
Yeah, if I could just build on what Makyba just said, there's one area that mirrors what she's talking about. And within AGU, we have a heavy focus on our mentorship program, Mentorship 365, getting platforms established and making sure those connections are available. But the one unique program we have is I'm going to call it focusing around environmental justice, just because of the nature of our science. We have a program called the Thriving Earth Exchange, where we connect our scientists and we give them training on how to talk to a community. You don't go in and say, oh, I have the answers to your problem. You understand what their needs are and you help them work through and understand their potential solutions and give them a voice in the process. But that's been a very successful initiative for us. The majority of our projects in the Thriving Earth Exchange are in, I'm going to call underserved communities, and it's very global in scope. And it's also attracting, helping to attract a lot more early career scientists into this space. In the geosciences, our diversity numbers, our representation within the ethnic and racial groups is poor. That's the best way to say it is very poor, about 4% in the US, Black, and in less than 10% Hispanic. So we have a lot of work to do, but some of the stuff we're doing now in terms of addressing, focusing heavily on environmental justice, as well as our mentorship program, we're seeing impacts of that. Thanks.
I got one quick thing to add in. And this is a little bit wonky, I guess, but we recently ran a consultation with a membership and ended up changing the society's constitution to significantly extend the remit of what had previously been called the Minority Affairs Committee and is now the Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion Committee to include explicitly a role in guiding decision-making around leadership structures and appointments, specifically in terms of the nominations committee for election ballots and things like that. So this again is another place where we can have an immediate impact, immediate change by increasing the number of people and the kinds of people involved in making some of the decisions that identify future leaders of the organization.
Ian, I don't want to hog the conversation, but I think this is a really critical question you're asking. So I just wanted to return to one point that Makyba said, which she framed in terms of imposter syndrome, but it's also for us at AIP, it has led to our real focus on the word belonging. Often folks call what we're all engaged in is DEI, but we felt that was really, it's too easy to think about DEI in terms of checking boxes. You can include people, you can have diversity, you can even potentially have programs for equity. But if you don't have the belonging and the accessibility really along with those, for us at AIP, that was critically why we added those two extra letters, because we know from our own social science research that we've done at AIP into the physical sciences community, and particularly the underrepresentation of African Americans in physics and astronomy, we know that matter, that issue of belonging and the sense of really belonging in this community and what physics education researchers call physics identity, the growth of that perception by oneself and by others around you that you can be a physics, you are and can be a physicist and astronomer, that those are really key factors in determining the outcomes for any programs that we may put in place. And so I just really wanted to underscore for us at AIP anyway, when we think about what we're doing as an organization, that issue of belonging and that everybody not only feels that they're included and participating in a diverse activity, but they belong at the table, they belong in the community, and they belong in the community of scientists is really critically important.
That definitely brings to mind, in terms of belonging, like going beyond recruiting, right? This kind of like recruiting in and of itself isn't going to address diversity issues, it's belonging. What then of other related efforts like retention and success in these particular communities? How do you prioritize these? How do you address them in your DEI efforts?
William, for us, it's really understanding what those specific issues are, what our specific areas are. And for us, that means, and when I talked about the dashboard where you take measurements, the qualitative questions that we ask of the members, of each member, is not only for all the members, but we can also cut that by different demographics. And it gets at the issue that, that Michael pointed out, he called it belonging, but you can query and know what your members are experiencing. And like you said, you can have diversity without people in a toxic environment. And so people are not going to stay there long enough to actually advance, because who wants to be in a toxic environment? So I think one of the key items here in terms of understanding what's happening is to have some type of regular measurement of your culture within your organization. And this is not only true for professional societies, but anywhere, even in your home institution, in your academic institution, the leaders should understand what the people are experiencing, because a lot of time we have a blind eye to what's actually going on.
That also brings to mind then, in addition to sort of like pulse surveys or community surveys, what does the pathway for decision making, what does the process look like for starting DEI initiatives for addressing where efforts should be going?
I think for us at AIP anyway, one of the important questions we've been asking ourselves over the last nearly 5 years now has been, as a, you know, a moderately sized organization, where can we have impact and where can we move the needle and be strategic in where we apply, you know, as a nonprofit organization, where we can apply the resources we can best bring to the table. And sometimes that's a narrow focus and sometimes that's a broad focus. And so for us at AIP, we've made a decision, for instance, to have a very tight laser focus on the topic I mentioned earlier, regard to the underrepresentation of African Americans in physics and astronomy. And that's motivated by a number of reasons, but the most important one is that we know, because of the work we do in our statistics research at AIP over decades, that we have a significant and enduring crisis in physics and astronomy with the persistent underrepresentation of African Americans. And after a 2-year study, we know the dynamics that lead to that underrepresentation, and we have a strategy to try to address it. And so we're staying laser focused on that community, while also working with our member societies on efforts that they're trying to do. For instance, the American Physical Society or the American Association of Physics Teachers, who are really working on systemic change within physics and astronomy more broadly in the American Astronomical Society. So I think being willing to make those choices about where one as an organization can have the most impact, and impact in a way that we think we can measure for AIP, has been a really important first step for us.
I'll jump in and say, similar to what Billy mentioned, representation, and Michael, representation for us in this dental, oral, and craniofacial research space is poor, right? There's no way to get around that. So what we've done is looked at what are some of the reasons why, and we've narrowed it down to that transition from postdoc over to having an independent research career. We are finding that more African Americans, more persons of color, are actually receiving doctoral degrees, but moving forward into that independent research career step, that's a weak spot. So we have become ultra focused on providing mentorship to kind of help with that transition. And we've employed a kind of pay it forward method where you're a mentee right now, but we're training you as to what good mentorship looks like, so that when you cross that bridge, you are then able to pay that forward to the next generation that is coming behind you. So we've developed a lot of educational content that serves towards that purpose. And we have several programs that will support that. But luckily for us, finding groups and organizations that have a similar focus and teaming up so that we reduce redundancy, I think is really important, right? So I'm focused on one area, you are focused on another, and we can pull that together to add, to kind of move the needle on getting more persons of color where they would like to be and where they are interested in being.
If I could just piggyback on that, what Makyba mentioned about finding organizations that that you can share or check things together, that's so critical in this area. This whole concept of partnership and collaboration, it can multiply or really amplify your efforts. And I can't say enough about that. I think that was the spirit behind that consortium that Crispin mentioned, that his organization is a member of, AGU is a member of, I think AIP is a member of as well. So this collaboration, I think we're seeing it now in the DEI area more than we ever have before. Organizations aren't going at this as a singular effort. We're sharing, openly sharing our learning, sharing resources, sharing best practices. And I think that's one of the keys to our future success in this area, that we're all after the same bigger objective on how we change this culture.
That reminds me to somewhat related. As far as considerations for underrepresented minorities, should there be differences in efforts towards, let's say, African-American, Black versus Mexican-American versus Asian versus international versus persons with disabilities or LGBTQ+.
Can I answer that question, Ian? Because we get that question a lot because of our team up effort. And the answer is there is no singular answer to that question. It is dependent on the priorities of the organization in some respect, but also it's really dependent on the dynamics of the scientific community you're trying to impact. So we know from, as I said, decades of measuring the dynamics in physics and astronomy undergraduate classes, that despite the fact that over the course of a decade, the numbers of physics degrees being issued at undergraduate institutions across the country doubled over the course of 10 years. The number of African Americans graduating essentially stayed flat. Now, that was not the case with other underrepresented minorities, nor is it the case around the gender balance, which trended in the same general direction as the overall numbers of graduates. But for African Americans, there was clear data to show that there was a persistent and critical injustice underrepresentation going on in the community. So in physics and astronomy, for AIP, it made sense for us to focus on that particular challenge and to address it as an egregious injustice from the past that we are trying to move the needle on. And we're hoping to double the number of African Americans graduating from physics and astronomy in the course of about 10 years. And we can measure that because we continue to do the demographic research. So that was the reason why we're taking that focus. Should that be the focus for other communities? Not for me to say. And not to say that there aren't other very challenging and very compelling and important areas of work to do across the DEI spectrum. But this is why I mentioned earlier how important it is for us anyway at AIP, how important it is for us to have been intentional, data-driven, research-driven about where we were going to apply the resources we could bring to the table with a hope of having a real impact that we could measure in the future. And so we're finding that for some partners that works. Other partners want to take a different direction, and that's good too. And we can work together, like Billy and others were talking about, being about coordinating, partnering, so that we all are moving the overall needle in the direction that we all want to go through the various strategies.
Yeah, we actually hear from different segments of our community when they they think we're they're being ignored. But I think we try to, as Michael said, try to address the issues where they're most pressing or most urgent. For example, over the past 2 years, when there was a lot of anti-Asian, not only harassment, but assault and discrimination and other things, we turned a lot of our attention to supporting our Asian American scientists within our community. And they now have spun up their own affinity group within the geosciences. And we have given them a home within AGU, helped them get established. And that type of support was very much appreciated. But we were doing that at the same time we were pushing heavily against all forms of systemic racism, responding to the appeal of our Black and Brown geoscientists. And so we're lucky in AGU that our Office of Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion has 4 staff members, so we can kind of spread out and conquer, but also collaborate with other groups at the same time to help make sure that no one is feeling ignored.
With that, I am thank you so much for all the panelists' questions for my moderated questions. I know I have like a dozen more, but I want to be mindful of the audience, the attendees' questions. So with that, I'm going to switch over to attendee-based questions, and I'm going to try and keep them broad enough that all panelists can answer some of them. Can the panelists maybe speak as to discussions and efforts towards addressing persons with disabilities and disability-related issues at their societies?
I can take a stab at starting that one. We've got a long way to go, but we're acutely aware of that. And this is sort of across the board, including physical disabilities, mental disabilities, and others. So again, we'll be looking to implement change where it is most easy, quick to do so. For example, ensuring that all of our web properties and our webinars are appropriately structured with closed captionings and so on and so forth. And to the extent that our conferences are online or offer online participation opportunities, then the same thing vis-a-vis captioning and that kind of technology. In terms of physical conference spaces, then I think we can use things like codes of conduct as anchors and statements of expectation of everyone's behavior vis-a-vis everybody at the conference, regardless of their ability, their ethnicity, their identity. But I think having robust reporting structures to ensure that anybody who is discriminated against can let us know that and know that we will respond to those concerns is really important. We're paying more attention again to the physical footprint for people with physical disabilities to make sure that those are not impediments to getting around and participating fully in in-person conferences. They're not exactly rearranging the deck chairs. They're small first steps with the recognition that we ASPB have a lot more to do.
Yeah, we at AGU have a lot more work to do here as well. We do have a focus in this area. There is an organization in the geosciences that provides some specialty in addressing people with physical disabilities in the geosciences. And for example, we sponsor workshops, field workshops at our meetings. We are sure that it accommodates people with disabilities. And so if you think about people doing field research, so this group provides resources to let instructors in academic institutions know you could have people with physical disabilities still doing very effective field research. So we help promote that organization, help support that organization as well. And they also call us out when we're not doing what we should be doing in our meetings anyplace else. So again, a lot more we can do and should do, but that's one of our focus areas as well.
Dr. Makyba.
Yeah, I just wanted to add really quickly, I think this lends itself to the previous question where, you know, no community, no underrepresented, underserved population is the same, right? Each of them has unique needs. I think there are six different types of disabilities, and within those disabilities, there are different pockets. So in addition to doing the things that we all know are standard, like the closed captioning and, you know, providing ease of access, our members let us know where we're weak. And it's really important to continuously take a pulse of the persons that you serve, right? Because we are a service-based organization is how I see us. So every group is different. The needs, we are focused on meeting the needs of our members and then attending to what they see as a broader context to apply the things and the initiatives that we have.
I'm kind of curious now that several of the panels have mentioned sort of the membership bringing some amount of, let's say, accountability. What other methods of accountability are integrated into your DEI efforts and leadership?
I think this goes somewhat to what we were talking about earlier about intentionality and having structures in place that people know what clearly what the organizational priorities are, and therefore our governance structures through our boards, and that can hold us accountable and we can hold ourselves accountable. So we try to be very transparent at AIP about those principles. The other element is, especially for us as an organization that doesn't have individual members, our members are other organizations. We're in constant contact with our complete membership, if you will, through the 10 member societies. It's pretty easy for us to have an ongoing dialogue with them about how we can be held accountable to the elements of our strategic framework and otherwise in this area. But then also to really be intentional about reaching out into the community more broadly to hold ourselves accountable. And so we have an advisory committee, for instance, called the Liaison Committee on Underrepresented Minorities that has been doing this work now for a long time and actually led to the study that led to the team up activity on the underrepresentation of African-Americans. So we were presenting data to them over a long period of time saying we have this problem of representation. And then they held AIP accountable and said, well, what are you, AIP, going to do about it? And so that sort of committee structure, again, for us is a very important element of accountability where, we've been doing the hard work to show underrepresentation, but we had not been doing the equally important work, if not critically important work, to actually begin to try to address the issues that our data were showing. And so the accountability absolutely is another element that you have to completely hardwire into the diversity programs.
Our next question from the audience was asking if Dr. Taylor, and more broadly to the whole panel, could elaborate on safe spaces for individuals, and how do you nurture safe space environments throughout your orgs?
So if I may share my screen, I can show you this one example, which is answering the first part of the question, but not really the second part. So this is the front page of Changing Cultures and Climates. And this front and center tab, as I mentioned, it has two components. We have an Instagram account where we're raising up the visibility of minoritized people in our communities. But the one you're really interested in is over here on the right side. It's called Adventitious Roots, which is sort of a term of art. But it is a Discord server that is open by invitation. The members of the community who are running the server and guiding the conversations that are taking place within it will welcome folk into the community when they put their hands up and ask to be invited. We haven't got many metrics around this yet. It's a relatively small number of people who are participating right now. But I expect that this, which is, a collaborative effort between two of the six, seven members of the Root and Shoot RCN, will expand into the rest of the RCN and hopefully gain visibility and traction that way. And to the extent that the qualitative feedback from the people that are participating in this particular community demonstrates that it's helpful to them, there's no reason that we couldn't replicate the process or the structure for other communities that need safe spaces in order to counter the biases and hurdles and barriers that are placed in front of them by the institutional racism that exists throughout STEM, or for other reasons too.
I could just add to that. I think it's one of the things we've been trying to do is to really think about, you know, for instance, if we think about society meetings, the whole meeting should be a safe space for every member of the organization. That's the goal that we're trying to get to. So we've engaged with our member societies, we're coming up some principles or a toolbox for thinking about best practices at member society meetings. And that can be some of the work that I know, for instance, you, Billy, at AGU have done with about training members, your members to wear a button that they can be approached, they're approachable. That's one of the elements of the toolbox. There are other things you can do about being intentional about how you design various meeting spaces, how you engage with vendors in the exhibit space to really just, again, hardwire it into the whole meeting planning effort to provide the whole of the meeting to eventually be a space that is safe for every member to interact and bring their authentic selves to. And so I think whereas there may be value as we make our way there for some sort of refuge, if you will, within a meeting, the ultimate goal should be that the safe space is the whole meeting and every interaction with our organization in the future. So I hope that's a little bit helpful.
Yeah, the program that Michael referred to at AGU, we call it Safe AGU. It is specifically for our meetings where we do train our staff and some volunteers when we can vet them to be trained, and they actually act as a link to any member at the meeting. If we have a meeting with 22,000 people, you're gonna have a few bad actors in the group. And so this helps provide a place where people know that there's someone they can turn to, also a lot of signage on who to contact if you have issues, and we follow up on all of those things. And believe me, there are things you need to follow up on at a meeting that large. And we are authorized to take immediate action without taking it back to some type of review. So we address those things at the meeting. And believe it or not, bad things do happen at scientific meetings.
I'm curious. So we're running low on time and maybe have the opportunity to have two more questions and then followed by ending statements of the panelists and closing statements by the sponsors of today's meeting. So I guess really quickly, my two questions are one related to an anonymous attendee who asks if the panelists have any advice for encouraging those doing DEI efforts, how to make it more, I guess, accessible or approachable to varying audiences that may not necessarily see the value or the worth of those efforts. And then my final question, which I want to kind of wrap into it, which I apologize, it's a little long. How do we ensure that our actions today for DEI are not performative, but they're transformative and impactful for marginalized communities? What are the conversations that should be happening after this meeting? What should we be doing?
So one piece of advice I give anyone who is leaning into or trying to engage in change in the DEI space is to be ready to be engaged for the long haul. You're not going to see immediate results. So if you think you're going to come in and spend, I'm going to spend 6 months on this or 1 year on this, and then I'm out, you probably haven't done very much, but maybe you can change yourself in that period of time, but you likely won't have that much impact. So I would say my advice is, if you're leaning into this space, welcome, but be ready to truly engage. Find yourself a community of like-minded people to support you, because you're going to get pushback. You're going to feel sometimes you're getting beat up, and you need to have some support around you. So make sure you're in for the long haul, and make sure you know who your support network is in this space.
To the first part of the question, one part of the answer might be to recognize and reward the actions that the individuals are taking, just as we do other kinds of contributions in our disciplines. So we are currently fundraising for an Excellence in Diversity and Inclusion Award that would cover the scenario potentially that is listed in the question, as well as many, many others. But the point is, as professional societies, one of the things we do is recognize and reward the contributions of our members. And recognizing and rewarding contributions in this space, in my opinion, is just as important as any other kind.
I'll be brief. I just want to add this. In the last few years, there has been an increase in DEI efforts, right? We're seeing a lot of people getting involved in it, trying to make an impact. But I think what is key is the length of time that folks have funding to get involved in these sorts of efforts. It may be too brief for the types of systemic changes that we need to enact. And that's the bottom line. We need to look at the funding for this on a longer haul. And then also, I like this idea of rewarding these sorts of champions who work in this space, because it allows you to get down on a more communal level. And I think some of the programs do miss that, where we think we know what it needs, but we haven't heard it from the people who need it. So getting down to that more of a community-based approach, I think, is critical to ensure that we're not just putting on a program, but we're doing something that will be more impactful and more sustainable too for the communities that we are trying to serve.
Yeah, if I could riff off Makyba for a moment. I think the utility of storytelling can't be underemphasized here when you're trying to bring along our communities of practice with this urgent task we have as scientists to address DEI. I've seen it very effective over the last 3-4 years that we've been building out our programs. To the data certainly are impactful because we're a scientist, we're driven by data. But as and sometimes more impactful are the individual stories of students, of faculty who feel excluded, who felt driven from our community, and telling those stories in a very authentic way is very impactful. And so that's really important, I think, for bringing along the communities of practice, which I think was the element of the first question. And then the second part I think it's really important, as everybody says, to understand this is a long-term goal. Even for us with our team-up activities, 10 years to double the number of African-American students, even though we're only talking, in the hundreds here, is still an ambitious goal, because these needles are slow to move. And so even programs that are funded by our grantors of, 3-year programs or so, they're just scratching the surface. They have to be part of a decade-long program which has clear goals. And for us as well, it's important that we think we can measure those goals, that we really know over that period of time that we're actually having an impact. So this is really critically important work, but likely to outlast the tenure of many colleagues in senior roles across organizations, or the tenures of any one president or board or set of board members. And so that long-term commitment is really critical.
Thank you so much for that. So as we're approaching the end of our webinar, I wanted to thank everyone for attending, for posting questions, even though we may not have gotten to your questions. But I'd like to just pose right now a question to all attendees. If you enjoyed this conversation, please let us know. Please let us know if we should be having other types of conversations, if there are people that aren't at the table that should be at the table that we need to include, what other activities would be engaging in this space. Help us to form where we go on this journey into ensuring that diversity and equity and inclusion are essentially a pillar, are part of the foundation of our societies and organizations. That's really important to us. With that, I am going to throw it over to each one of our panelists for a final 30-second closing comment, and then I'll be throwing it after that to our hosts. So if we want to start off with Dr. Makyba, any closing statements?
Yeah, thank you. Just really quickly, these sorts of conversations are important. It was very heartwarming to hear you say that we really want to make this a pillar of our organization. Having these kinds of conversations is how we start stirring in that direction for many organizations. So I will say, keep going in that direction. And also our organization, please get involved with us if you are interested in our DEI efforts, as well as in dental, oral, or craniofacial research. And I'll hand it over.
Thank you. Mr. Maloney, would you like to give a statement?
Thanks, Ian. Well, thanks to you and to the sponsors for this opportunity. First of all, as was just said, these conversations are so critically important for us to have and to disseminate as well. And so the only thing is, along with thanks, is to, for anybody who wants to know more about what we're doing, Giovanni Spinner and Arlene Modesti-Knowles, who are on the call today, or myself at AIP, would be happy to engage with any and all of you and to learn more about what we're doing. So just help us by reaching out to us so that we can really elevate the conversation in the community broadly.
Thank you, Mr. Maloney. Mr. Williams, would you like to give a closing comment?
So again, thank you for inviting me. This is a great discussion. Glad to see this conversation take place. One thing I would say to the participants here are either student or early career scientists, do not underestimate your power, the power of your voice and the power you have to affect change. Because a lot of the change that we have on the way, even within our organization, was motivated by the voices of our student early career scientists. So know your power and use it for good. So keep at it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Williams. And then to Dr. Crispin Taylor.
I mean, this is the hard thing, right? Coming at the end of these wonderful closing statements from everyone else. So basically what they said, and that it is a marathon, not a sprint. And so that, you know, while I'm thrilled that ASPB and our sibling societies have this major award, it is only 5 years. And figuring out how to make whatever transformations we implement sustainable over the long term is what keeps me up at night. So any ideas in that regard, please send them along. And yes, if any of you affiliate towards plant biology, please feel free to reach out directly.
Again, thank you to all four of our panelists. And with that, I'm gonna throw it over to Annabelle and Tristan.
Awesome. Thank you so much, EM. Thank you all of the panelists for your time and efforts. I know we are at time, but I want to give an actionable item for some of our early career researchers and scientists out there. And for folks, if you want to get involved within NSPN, we too have a Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Committee. You can get in contact with us, learn what we're doing. We actually have an upcoming webinar where we're going to be hearing from some folks in the Sloan Foundation, the Association for Research of Regional Colleges, and Dr. Andrew Kern, who was the winner of a recent Journal of Science Policy Governance and AAAS policy position paper competition about shaping the future of science policy. And our focus is going to be on the case for rural America, investing in education and science. We welcome all of you to join us on Thursday, December 16th, 3 p.m. Eastern, 12 p.m. Pacific, for this awesome conversation. And that's sort of what's recent, what's upcoming in the DEI space, but you can get plugged in to learn more about what we have to offer. And I'm going to go ahead and hand it off to Melissa to give the last hurrah.
Oh, wow. Yeah. So stay connected with us on social media. Again, if you look on our website, one of the dropdowns has more information about our racial equity initiatives. You can read the report that I mentioned at the top. And please do join the Science Network if you haven't already, so you can stay in touch with us and hear about more webinars like this and ways to integrate and center equity and advocacy in your work. Thanks again to NSPN for partnering with us on this webinar.
All right. Thank you all, and I hope you all have a wonderful rest of your day.